أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم وميثاقه الذي واثقكم به وميثاقه الذي واثقكم به إذ قلتم سمعنا وأطعنا واتقوا الله إن الله عليم بذات الصدور يا أيها الذين آمنوا كونوا قوامين لله شهداء كونوا قوامين لله شهداء بالقسط ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم ألا ألا تعدلوا عدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. And always remember the blessings which God has bestowed upon you and the solemn pledge by which He bound you to Himself when you said, "We have heard and we pay heed." Hence remain conscious of God. Verily, God has full knowledge of what is in the hearts. O believers, be ever steadfast in your devotion to God, bearing witness to the truth in all equity, and never let hatred of anyone lead you into the sin of deviating from justice. Be just, this is closest to being God-conscious, and remain conscious of God. Verily, God is aware of all that you do. Sadaqallahu al-Azim.
As you all know that this is an exclusive talk by Mr. Rahimullah Yusufzai Saab on the subject, and we have Ambassador Sadiq Saab in chair as well. Rahimullah Yusufzai Saab is a Pakistani senior journalist and analyst. He is one of the few bona fide experts on Afghanistan, and he has been covering Afghanistan since 1979. Rahimullah Saab is currently the bureau chief and bureau chief of Jungs Group, the News International at Peshawar office. He has also served as Times Pakistan correspondent, and he is also currently the correspondent of BBC's Pashto and Urdu services in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province of Pakistan. Rahimullah Yusufzai Saab is considered as an authority on Afghan affairs and federally administered tribal areas of Pakistan. He frequently appears on national and international media on the subject. Acknowledging his achievements in journalism, the government of Pakistan has awarded him with Tamgha-e-Imtiaz, Medal of Excellence in 2005, and then Sitara-e-Imtiaz Award, Star of Excellence in 2010. Sir, thank you for being here. On the other hand, we have Ambassador Mohammad Sadiq Saab, who will be chairing this session. He is a career diplomat, and he has served as Secretary in National Security Division of Pakistan. Before that, he served as Ambassador of Pakistan to Afghanistan. He also remained a spokesman of Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Islamabad. During his diplomatic assignments abroad, he has served in Washington, Beijing, and Brussels, etc. Moreover, Ambassador Saab has represented Pakistan in several bilateral and multilateral meetings and conferences abroad. He has also lectured on foreign affairs related topics at different national and international forums. So thank you very much for being here. Before I hand over the proceedings to the chair, I would like to request our Executive President, Institute of Policy Studies, Islamabad, Mr. Khalid Rahman, to present welcome remarks. Mr. Khalid Rahman.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I would also like to take this opportunity to welcome all of you, excellencies who are present here from different embassies. And would like to begin with recognizing that the subject we are discussing today is extremely important, yet it is not in any way new to an audience such as the one sitting here. I'm sure few would disagree that Afghanistan and its concerning matters, particularly US policies, fall among the most significant themes that have been studied in academic circles or presented on international media or would have been deliberated in policy arenas in the past few decades. Institute of Policy Studies, as many of you would be aware, was established in 1979, the year the Soviets invaded Afghanistan, and then it was quite natural that it included Afghanistan in its agenda since the very beginning. Looking back today, with several hundred reports, large number of conferences and seminars, and a number of publications on the subject to our credit, we may feel somewhat satisfied that we have been and are playing our part in solving the problem of Afghanistan. I say somewhat, realizing that the problem still remains unresolved and inviting all stakeholders, and let me use, to do more. It may be pertinent to quote here what Professor Khurshid Ahmed, chairman of the Institute of Policy Studies, had stated while introducing an IPS book, Red Clouds Over Afghanistan. The book discusses Soviet Union's invasion in Afghanistan and its implications, and was published in May 1980, at a time when Islamabad was hosting the OIC meeting concerning the same subject. It was among the few first publications of IPS. Professor Khurshid wrote, and it is presented over there also, "Afghanistan is in flames. The fire that has engulfed it not only threatens Pakistan, Iran, and the Gulf, but also pose a real challenge to world peace and tranquility." It has almost been four decades since then, and Afghanistan is still under the blaze. In fact, these flames now have become even more significant as a whole new cohort of destructive weapons, including mother of all bombs, has already been used there. Just as dreaded by Professor Khurshid Ahmed at that time, the Afghan inferno had such repercussions at the global level that it has substantially altered the chessboard of the regional and global political landscape. And interestingly, ladies and gentlemen, when we look at this altered setting, we find the same players are active in the field, yet in most cases, the roles have changed or rather reversed. Nevertheless, the irony is that the fire in Afghanistan still seems far from having been extinguished. Speaking rather in clearer terms, Washington's interference in Afghanistan had started in the beginning of 1980s, but the role of America at that time was starkly different from what it is now, and so was the approach of international organizations as well as the global opinions under the American influence and leadership. The turbulent nature of events that followed saw another armed intervention in Afghanistan, this time under the leadership of America. And tomorrow, we all know, will mark the completion of exactly 16 years to this intervention, as it had taken place precisely on October 7, 2001. Meanwhile, we have, after this intervention, witnessed three American presidents and five different administrations during these 16 years. But the question that keeps bothering is that what exactly does the American administration wants to achieve? Is reality the same as is and has been publicly portrayed? Or is there something else to it, or it is a combination of the two? Is the truth relevant today only to what is being stated or what has been surmised in this context? Or should it be accepted that, regardless of the nature of US targets, the situation in Afghanistan reflects a failure of US strategies, making Afghanistan an unsuccessful chapter for America, just as in the case of some preceding superpowers? And would the recently announced policy for President Trump help avert the failure, or at least this perception of failure? The issue will be easier to comprehend if I may be allowed to quote here the former Supreme Allied Commander of America and NATO forces in Afghanistan, James Stavridis, while writing in one of the recent issues of foreign policy. He says, and I quote, "The options are bad in Afghanistan. We could cut our losses, 2,400 Americans dead and 1 trillion spent, and depart. But that would eventually lead to another Vietnam movement with helicopters lifting off the roof of the US embassy. Another approach would be to return to a robust NATO-led operation with 150,000 troops doing the actual fighting, which was the size of the force when I ran the Afghan war as Supreme Allied Commander in 2009-2013. But there is no appetite for the level of commitment on either side of the Atlantic. And frankly, the entire world wrestles with profound Afghan fatigue. So we are left with the option that excites no one. A very modest increase of troops' strength, probably 4,000 US forces, and an equal number of allied, a conditions-based approach without a specific withdrawal time, and a revitalized regional strategy that puts more pressure on Pakistan. Sounds a lot like what was proposed in 2013 as we drew down our military forces by 90% and significantly cut foreign aid to Afghanistan. And yet, President Donald Trump calls this a new approach. Will it work? What should we really be doing?" This is the context, ladies and gentlemen, in which we are organizing today's seminar. I feel proud to address this seminar as a keynote speaker. We have an eminent personality who is considered one of the most prominent figures among the authorities deliberating upon Afghanistan and concerning issues, and who has also had the opportunities to apprehend the matters closely and significantly, insightfully, through direct interactions with most of the stakeholders. And as was introduced earlier, in the chair we have Ambassador Mohammad Sadiq. I'm sure all of us would like to also listen to him after Mr. Rahimullah Yusufzai has made his presentation and the question answer session is over. So with these few remarks, let me request Rahimullah Yusufzai sir to kindly come and present his.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning. First, my regrets. I lost my way. The earlier office of IPS was much easier. We could go straight to Jinnah supermarket and find it. But this place is new for me. And my driver also is not familiar with Islamabad. So, sorry again. As mentioned, 38 years of war and still no solution and still no end in sight. It's very unfortunate. And we keep discussing Afghanistan in the hope that we can talk about some solution. I'm afraid I will not be able to suggest any solution right here, but I will try to highlight the issues. The topic is very vast. 16 years of US presence in Afghanistan, objective strategies, and emerging scenarios. And I can see here among the audience so many luminaries, people who have served in Afghanistan, people who have served at different stages in their careers. So I think they will know a lot more than me. But I have hands-on experience on Afghanistan. I have been traveling all over Afghanistan. I have been to 28 provinces out of 34. And I can say I have met all the major actors in the Afghan conflict, beginning with the communist rulers, Babur Karmal, Dr. Najibullah, the Mujahideen, all the leadership, the Taliban, and the present setup in Kabul. So I know them personally. It's very significant that we are talking today on 5th of October. 2 days later would be the completion of 16 years of US invasion of Afghanistan. As we all know, it's already the longest war in American history, and it's unclear how long it is going to continue. Right now, there's another surge in troops taking place after the Bush and Obama surges. We forget about those surges. The Obama surge was a major one. 33,000 troops were sent. There was a military and also a civilian surge. It didn't achieve the objective. So now the US troop strength recently rose to 11,000 from 8,900, and it may go up to 14,000. As the NATO allies are being asked to contribute troops, the numbers could rise to about 20,000. Because 15 countries have already agreed to deploy troops. The fighting and reconstruction cost to the US are more than $1 trillion. Commitments could go until 2020, so there is no cutoff date yet. If we talk about the past, the US and NATO intervention was partially successful. Inflicted severe losses on Al-Qaeda. OBL Osama bin Laden was killed along with others. Many were captured. Al-Qaeda has been unable to launch big attacks. Another 9/11 seems unlikely. Still, Al-Qaeda has survived in the Afpak region. Dr. Zawahiri is still alive. Hamza bin Laden is alive somewhere in this region. And it has gained foothold in the Middle East and other places. Al-Qaeda's loss was the gain for ISIS. ISIS, Daesh, is more radical and ruthless. We all know it is on the retreat, but may not be totally defeated. Who knows what shape militancy and terrorism will take place in future? The war against terrorism could be perpetual, leaving the world unsafe for years. As we all know, Taliban were defeated within 8 to 9 weeks towards the end of 2001, but they managed to survive. And now as many agree, they are the strongest ever since losing power. Taliban gained strength in northern, western, central Afghanistan, where Taliban were traditionally weak. It is still a predominantly Pashtun organization, but there are now Uzbeks, Turkmen, and Tajik Taliban as well. Tajiks, especially in Badakhshan, Uzbeks throughout the north. That's very significant. Uzbeks becoming Taliban. Now, but look at the Taliban changing policies. Circumstances has forced Taliban to declare Afghan territory would not be used against any country. The same Taliban who harbored Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda. There could also be other likely changes in Taliban outlook. For example, they have announced that they will not be harming national assets in Afghanistan. They are supportive of TAPI, gas pipeline from Turkmenistan. They have been talking positively about girls' education. They say we will not be using the moral or religious police as they were doing in the past. They will allow the media to work. But we will have to see. The taste of the pudding is in the eating. So once they are in power, we'll see if they really mean to change their track. Now, Taliban have become so strong that earlier they were demonized and now being courted and offered peace talks and a share in power. There is a consensus that Taliban cannot be defeated. Obama declared it loud and clear. And all agree there can be no peace without Taliban. The stalemate in Afghanistan has been there for the last many years, but the US conceded this for the first time through the US NATO commander, General John Nicholson. This summer, both sides tried to break the stalemate, but couldn't. Intense fighting took place. There was a stiffening of positions, which means there was no real chance of starting a peace process. There are many reasons for the stalemate. Post-2014 security, political, economic transition took its toll. The NATO forces drawdown by December 2014 meant henceforth there would be no major offensive against Taliban. Military victory against Taliban has been ruled out, as it could not be achieved with a much larger force of 140 to 150,000 US-led coalition forces. We also have almost 450,000 Afghan security forces. I think Taliban were underestimated and the Afghan National Defense Security Forces were overestimated. The burden of fighting was transferred post-2014 to Afghan forces. They suffered record casualties and desertions. But we must also admit that the Afghan special forces, which are increasing in numbers and strength, they are doing very well in the battlefield, especially in emergencies. And if they are able to raise the strength of Afghan special forces, they could be used in difficult situations. The coalition forces, including the Afghan forces, are mostly fighting a defensive war, while Taliban are on the offensive. Taliban have also suffered heavy casualties, but they have managed fresh recruitment. We haven't seen any drop in their recruitment. US military says Afghan government forces' losses are unsustainable in the long term. The same can be said about Taliban. I'm unsure about the sustainability factor, as both sides have been fighting for years, especially in the post-2014 period. They have been fighting for the last 2.5 years, and they are willing to fight on. So I think this needs to be looked into, whether they can sustain the losses. They are sustaining the losses. The Afghan casualty figures are the highest in the 16-year war. This figure is striking. Average of 31 Afghan soldiers and police plus 9 civilians are killed every day, 31. Violence caused deaths of 6,000 security personnel, 3,500 civilians last year, but only 14 American service members were killed last year in 2016. The US has managed to minimize its casualties because the numbers are less, because they are mostly barricaded and their air bases in Bagram, Kandahar and elsewhere. So there has been no adverse public opinion at home. That's the biggest care which the US is taking to ensure that there are less casualties of young American soldiers. Despite the broad consensus that there is no military solution, all sides continue to focus on war, then peace. Taliban, as we all know, announced their spring-summer offensive this year. Afghan government also launched operations, including one called Shafaq. On top of it, new US policy announced by President Trump on August 21 is declaration of new round of war that has no end in sight. IS fighters are about 25,000, and they say more could come once ISIS is defeated in Iraq and Syria. Russians have put the figure at 6,000. Russia also justifying its contacts with the Afghan Taliban by arguing that they could jointly fight ISIS because the Afghan government is not of much help. Both sides deny that the Russians are arming the Taliban, but there are reports from Kunduz that there are some contacts across the border between Afghanistan and Tajikistan. Now, we have to be careful because we all criticize Trump's new policy on Afghanistan and South Asia. I think there's a lot more support in the US and also abroad for Trump's new policy than his other policies. His other policies may be opposed, criticized, but his Afghan policy and Pakistan policy is getting a lot of support. In fact, Trump has reaffirmed US commitment to Afghanistan, which President Ghani says was needed and was being awaited by the Afghan people and many other people around the world. So this is going to be a long haul. Pakistan ought to take Trump seriously because I heard people making comments which sometimes look very unrealistic, like these comments made by the Prime Minister and the Foreign Minister or the Defense Minister saying beforehand that the Afghan policy of President Trump is going to fail. They can say it in a different way. They can say there is no military solution. But by saying in advance that the policy is going to fail, I think Pakistan will get the blame. The policy will fail, we all know. But you know, if you say it, then they will say that, look, Pakistan has a role in trying to foil the American policy. It is said that Trump thinks out of the box, but his policy has got heavy input from three army generals, including Secretary of Defense, General James Mattis, Chief of Staff, General John Kelly, and National Security Advisor, General McMaster. It's very clever of Trump. If it fails, he can say, the generals advise me. If it works, he can say, it is my policy. By the way, General John Nicholson has never met Trump, but he's supposed to lead the US military to victory in Afghanistan. And we all read in the media that Trump once reportedly threatened to fire him for failing to win the Afghan war. Now, is victory possible? I already said this. It looks very unlikely. But there are no real chances for the US or Taliban to achieve victory, though Taliban momentum could be slowed down. Use of intensive air power will stop Taliban from making major gains. I think we are already seeing the start of heavy US bombardment in many different areas, either to those areas where there was no such military or air campaign earlier. Taliban don't have anti-aircraft missiles. If they had these kind of missiles, as were given to the Afghan Mujahideen against the Soviet forces, you remember Stinger and blowpipe missiles given by the US and UK, then it could have made a difference. But they have captured heavy US weapons. It has been reported in the US media also. And those weapons are fairly effective. They also have a number of Humvee vehicles, which are resistant to the IEDs and which are very tough. So, but you know, look at the situation right now. The Afghan officials are excited that B-52 bombers will return to action, because these were withdrawn. They will now return to action. And as I am saying, air power will be increasingly used, inevitably leading to civilian casualties. And that will put pressure on the Afghan government. If there are more civilian casualties, Karzai used to react immediately and strongly. Ashraf Ghani has not been doing that, but he may come under pressure if there are more civilian casualties. I think there will be a long stalemate. More fighting will reduce chances of peace process. A weakened Taliban will lead to splintering of the movement, but still there will be no real chances of peace. Presently, Taliban not ready for peace talks with the Afghan government or power sharing. They also fear divisions in their ranks, as their fighters mostly oppose peace talks, while the politicians, the so-called moderates, they are weak. They may be in favor of peace talks, but they cannot decide this. It will be decided by the field commanders and the fighters. Now, Taliban say that the Afghan government as partner for peace is not credible. They say Afghan government is divided and powerless, so it cannot deliver. They also are not convinced that the deal made by Hizb-e-Islami Hikmat-Yar can be replicated in their case, because their argument justifiably is that Hikmat-Yar had no choice. He was militarily weak. Taliban want to talk to the US. They have been talking to the US. They made a deal also through Qatar for the exchange of one American soldier for 5 Taliban commanders who were being held in Guantanamo. But the US, as far as I know, has not yet accepted. It is a party to the conflict. It is one of the important parties to the conflict. It has to take responsibility, because just saying that Taliban should talk to the Afghan government will not resolve the problem. The Americans have to get involved more than they are presently. But by the same yardstick, same argument, the Afghan government says, why not talk to Pakistan, which controls the Taliban? They say that, you know, Pakistan is actually influencing the Taliban, so we should talk to Taliban and to Pakistan first. But I think it's a wrong approach, because Taliban, as far as I know, are no pushovers. And Pakistan may be having influence. The influence is negative, in my view, because you arrest them, put them behind bars for years, and you think that that is the kind of influence you have. We arrested more than 50 Taliban leaders. We released about 44, 46. We are still holding a number of them. Mullah Abdul Ghani Biradar, Mullah Ahmadullah Nane, 2 Shura members, they are being held, along with many others. But that actually cannot give you decisive influence on Taliban. So that is the policy right now. But many Taliban leaders, as far as I know, have shifted to other places. There are still quite a few in Pakistan. There's still quite a few Afghan Taliban leaders, quite a few Haqqani network people here in Pakistan, but many have shifted to Afghanistan. Some have gone to Iran, Some are in Qatar, a few are in the UAE, and many of them are moving across the border. So the lesser number of Taliban and Afghani network people in Pakistan, the less influence Pakistan will have. And that is, I think, happening right now. The Afghan unity government is united only in name. Decision making is affected and slowed down due to the Ghani-Abdullah differences. I expect to tussle between the two to intensify in next year's elections for parliament. July 7th has been declared as the date of polling. We don't know. Elections have been delayed for 3 years, so it may not be held if there is insecurity. And then 2019 election for president. These will intensify the differences, but I think until then they will stay together because the US will not allow them to break the alliance. Another issue facing, along with many other issues, the Afghan government, the unauthorized gunmen in the north. Nobody mentioned this issue, but these are the people who are being controlled by politicians and warlords, including the Speaker of the National Assembly from Kunduz, Ibrahim. They control these gunmen. They collect illegal taxes, demand extortions, settle scores, fight each other, and make life difficult for the Afghan people and the Afghan government. I will quote the former Kunduz governor, Omar Sapi. He said, there were 3,000 policemen in Kunduz province, but there were 4,000 illegal, unauthorized gunmen in only two districts out of several in Kunduz, Khanabad and Imam Sahib. So you can imagine the challenge they pose to the government and to the people. We also have another aspect, civilian contractors, mercenaries. They have been creating problems for the Afghan government, but they were hired by the NATO forces. Figures are unavailable, how many are still there, but one previous figure was about, say, 27,000. So these are mostly foreigners, and they are for hire. These are mercenaries. Karzai opposed them, Ghani doesn't. Blackwater is off the agenda, but Eric Prince will continue lobbying that he should get the contract to deploy Blackwater in Afghanistan. And he says it will cost less, and there will be fewer casualties for the US and NATO forces. We often talk about negatives regarding Afghanistan, but we ignore the positives in post-Taliban Afghanistan. Let me count a few. The Afghan government has survived despite the NATO drawdown. There was disunity. For example, Vice President Dostum is in Turkey for several months. He cannot come back. A new three-party alliance of anti-Ashraf Ghani has been formed, including, ironically, Jamiat Islami, led by Foreign Minister Salahuddin Rabbani, despite being part of the unity government. So he's in the government and in the opposition. But I am convinced this government was formed and mediated by Foreign Secretary John Kelly, the US, and the US will ensure that it survives, because the alternative will be chaos and maybe even civil war. So this government will stay together and maybe until the next elections. Another positive, 5 elections have been held, 3 for president and 2 for parliament. Democracy taking roots with Afghan characteristics, even though use of money, strong arm tactics and rigging in election is common, like Pakistan. The parliament is asserting itself. It has challenged President Karzai earlier and Ghani now, and even disqualified ministers. It's unlike Pakistan. The parliament has to give trust of vote to the ministers. They can be refused trust of vote, they can be removed. Even now, several ministers are acting ministers because they have not got the trust of vote from the parliament. There are no political parties in parliament, but political groups have taken shape around personalities or common interest platforms. However, ethnic polarization remains a challenge. And the formation of the three-party recent alliance against President Ghani is also based on ethnic politics. Ghani is Pashtun, and the three rival parties are non-Pashtun. And this may increase in future because, you know, the allegation is that Ghani is appointing Pashtuns to important positions, especially in the security setup. And that is the complaint by the non-Pashtuns. That is why, you know, Dostum has joined the opposition, although he is the vice president. Another positive, there are more Afghan children, including girls, in school than ever. And educational institutions up to the university level have come up in record numbers. There are now universities in almost all the provinces. Afghanistan GNP rose from $4 billion in 2001 to more than $20 billion, even if it's mostly due to foreign aid. Life expectancy increased by at least 10% due to availability of healthcare closer to population centers, quality of life improving with greater availability of electricity, water, roads, means of communication. There is a lot of development activity, and foreign assistance has created large number of jobs, not only for Afghans, but also for foreigners, including more than 100,000 Pakistanis. However, unemployment is still high, shortage of skilled manpower is there. Afghans were the second highest in numbers after the Syrians, illegally trying to reach Europe, risking everything. We can also interpret this as Afghans losing hope in Afghanistan's future. But another positive factor for the Afghan government, Afghan people, is that Ghani has been making efforts for regional connectivity, reducing dependence on Pakistan, as he says, for his landlocked country. There has been a drop in trade with Pakistan. It was $2.4 billion in 2012, and now it's about $1 billion. Although one major reason behind the drop in the trade is the pullout of the NATO forces, which were receiving supplies from Pakistan. Also, there is less transit trade through Pakistan, primarily due to the poor relations. We still have not been able to start negotiating the new Afghan-Pakistan Transit Trade Agreement. This agreement was signed in October 2010. It expired in 2015. There is no new agreement. There is no interest, I think, in Kabul for this kind of agreement. They have been demanding that Pakistan should allow the Afghan trucks going to India to cross over to Attari, then dropping their goods at Wagah. They want to cross the border because if they drop the goods at Wagah, then these goods have to be taken across the border, costing more and taking more time. We also know about the negatives in Afghanistan. You know, cultivation of poppy has increased manifold, as the UN has been reporting. Drug trafficking is on the rise, and Afghanistan remains one of the biggest suppliers of narcotics in the world. There has been no real anti-poppy campaign in Afghanistan. It's, you know, it takes place occasionally in some places. I don't know of any big drug lord who has been punished. At least one of them, Bashir Nurzai, was captured. He actually surrendered himself, and he is now in the US. So he was one of the big drug lords. Others have escaped punishment. Corruption is rampant, no doubt about that. Afghanistan is among always top three most corrupt countries in the world. Donors complain about corruption. Governance issues have not been tackled properly despite promises. Too much foreign assistance has also fueled corruption. Afghan government often blames foreigners for corruption, though it has failed to tackle it on its own. Chances of peace. We have discussed this already partially, but US aim is to stop Afghanistan from becoming safe haven for terrorists. Foreign assistance to give Afghan forces compelling battlefield advantage against Taliban. That is the objective. But this is debatable if that can happen. Trump policy is one-sided, too much stress on military solution and no nation building. After 16 years, he's saying, we are not there for nation building, they are there to kill terrorists. Political option was mentioned by Trump, but at the end of his speech, I believe it should have been in the beginning of the speech. First you try the political option, and then if you can't, then you start your military campaign. So, and I also, you know, if you talk to experts, they say that nation building actually can help you win the war against terrorism. Without that, it's not possible. Trump, while leaving the door open for peace deal with Taliban, you know, his words, someday, after an effective military effort, perhaps it will be possible to have a political settlement that includes elements of the Taliban in Afghanistan. It has got many ifs and buts. And he is hoping the military campaign will be effective and will destroy the Afghan Taliban. And he will be left with remnants of Taliban, and they will seek peace with the Afghan government. That is his idea. Right now, there is no active peace effort. Their Pak-Afghan reconciliation efforts and Chinese efforts are in the early stages. Russian peace initiative did not take off. The Kabul process launched earlier this year has little chance of success. British and Turkish efforts to reconcile Kabul and Islamabad did not make much headway. And more importantly, QCG, the Quadrilateral Coordination Group, the four-country group, Pakistan, Afghanistan, China, and the US, is dormant. Not disbanded, but not revived. Taliban, let's talk about Taliban, maybe their military situation and their politics. As far as I know, field commanders are autonomous. They plan their own operations. They are not always under the control of the Afghan Taliban shura, wherever it is. Though they seek resources, guidance, that is what they do. But by and large, they operate independently. Hebatullah Akhundzada, the new Taliban Amir, is a unifying figure, unlike Mullah Akhtar Mansur, who was divisive. But dissidents have returned to the fold, they have reconciled. People like Abdul Qayyum Zakir, Mullah Baz Muhammad, they have rejoined the movement. Earlier they were on the sidelines or they were with Mullah Rasool. But I think Hebatullah Akhundzada is still a weak leader because he is not a military man. He is dependent on people who are really powerful in the movement. Someone like Sadr Ibrahim, the head of the Taliban military commission. Gul Agha, who seems to be the most influential Shura members. Mullah Manan, the governor, the shadow governor of Helmand. Sirajuddin Haqqani. So all these military figures actually are much more powerful. And they dictate terms, not Hebatullah Akhundzada. Mullah Rasool group is now more or less irrelevant. He's in Pakistan's custody since the last many months. Taliban have left him, you know, people who had joined him, and they're rejoining Hebatullah Akhundzada. Or the Afghan government, someone like Mullah Abdul Manan Niazi, whom I knew as the governor of Herat, he actually has joined the Afghan government. He has been seen in Kabul. So there are a lot of people are, you know, joining and rejoining. And this Mullah Rasool group is not doing any fighting against the Afghan government. It is only fighting in places like Shindan and Herat against the Mullah Hebatullah group. But to its credit, the Afghan Taliban has not split widely. The split is very small. Mullah Rasool group, as I said, is irrelevant. Taliban remain resurgent. In fact, not being defeated by a superpower is an achievement for Taliban. But there are weaknesses. They tried in 2015, 2016, and now 2017, but they could not capture or hold on to major cities except Kunduz twice. Tried but failed to seize Tarinkot, the capital of Uruzgan, Lashkargah, the capital of Helmand, Farah, the capital of Farah province, Memana, the capital of Faryab province. But I have heard Taliban say that their main goal is not to seize cities, but to seize weapons, to break the jails, to release their prisoners, to get some money. That is what they do, and to destroy whatever is left in these towns and district headquarters. Because holding city is going to be very costly. It's not easy to hold a city because, for example, Kunduz, captured by about 500 Taliban fighters against 5,000 Afghan soldiers and policemen. But 500 Taliban fighters cannot hold the sixth largest city in Afghanistan, Kunduz. So I think it was less costly for them to retreat. Taliban are inherently undemocratic. They are inherently undemocratic. I don't expect them to, you know, in the next few years, to start supporting democracy, taking part in elections. I think their strength is force, military strength. But many Afghans, there's a consensus in Afghanistan among these mostly urban people and also many other Afghans, that the change should come through the ballot, not the bullet. That seems to be the emerging consensus. But Taliban still believe that they will be able to capture power by using the bullet. Let's talk briefly about Pakistan's role. Foreign involvement in Afghanistan has continued. But the oldest role and the most visible was the Pakistani role. Because we gave sanctuaries to the Afghan Mujahideen. We tolerated even the Afghan communist who lost power. And we allowed the Taliban to regroup. That's why it is more visible. We have been doing it since long. But there are other countries who are all equally involved. The so-called double game is played by a number of countries, not only in Afghanistan, but also elsewhere. Iran, Russia, India, Turkey, Saudi Arabia also interfering. When we talk about Turkey, for example, three important leaders, Taliban leaders, have taken refuge in Turkey. Agha Jan Mutasim, Abdul Rahman Pazwar, recently, about 2 weeks ago, and the third one, I'm forgetting his name. So, you know, you can get refuge in Turkey also. And India is there, Russia is there, Iran is there. We'll talk about it briefly, separately. Now, but another destabilizing factor or stabilizing factor is the presence of US-led NATO forces and also dozens of militant groups, non-state actors, more than 20, as President Ghani says. The US has been seeking deliverables from Pakistan. What can Pakistan do? You heard the statements. Pakistan will be given one more chance. Pakistan is supporting terrorist groups like the Haqqanis. So there are a lot of allegations coming out of Washington on a daily basis, putting pressure on Pakistan. But I think one single most important issue is the fate of the Haqqani network. That can further derail the Pakistan-US relations. If no action is taken, and I think even if Pakistan takes some kind of action, it will not be acceptable to the US. So that, I think, is the clenching argument. Whether Pakistan will do it, how, where, is it possible also? Because earlier there was a place which was identifiable. Dande Darpakhel village near Miranshah in North Waziristan was the place where the Haqqani family lived. That is no longer there after the Zarb-e-Azab military operation started in June 2014. Now, even if they are in Pakistan, they are scattered. There is no one place. There has been talk about Kurram Agency or Tari Mangal or whatever. I have been there. One cannot really see a large presence anywhere. We don't know. But this is going to be very important because the Americans, I believe, will try to kill some important Haqqani network commander anywhere in Pakistan to show that they are still here. Pakistan will not be able to deny it, like we have been denying the presence of Osama bin Laden or Akhtar Mansur or others, and they were captured or killed in Pakistan. So, you know, this is going to be the real issue between the two countries. You know, I was talking about different objectives of different countries. The US, it does not want the Afghan project to fail. It wants to deny Al-Qaeda and ISIS and other space in Afghanistan. It wants to sustain the Afghan government in power. It wants to keep up the pressure on Iran, Pakistan, China and Russia. Maybe it also wants to exploit the energy resources and the important precious resources in Afghanistan, as Trump is reportedly saying that American companies should take the contracts because American lives are being lost. American money is being spent in Afghanistan. I don't know whether it can work, because unless you have peace, you cannot really do mining or exploration. We know about what happened to the copper mines in Logar province. The Chinese signed a $3.2 billion contract, but work has stopped because of insecurity and because of other reasons. Russia, major concerns is Daesh. Security of Central Asian states and drugs from Afghanistan. And that's why they have established contacts with Taliban, because they believe Taliban also want to fight Daesh, so they have a common enemy. China, most important is terrorism, especially East Turkestan Islamic Movement, Islamic Movement of Uzbekistan, ISIS. Also, their interest is economic cooperation, investment, and they have signed a number of agreements with the Afghan government. I think China is becoming one of the biggest investors in Afghanistan. But again, that will depend on the security situation. India, terrorism, especially Kashmir linked, because in the past, they say there were some camps for Kashmiri fighters in Afghanistan, but that was under the Mujahideen. Also wants to keep Pakistan under pressure. It has strategic ties with Afghanistan. It has defense and security cooperation. India was the first country with which Afghanistan signed in 2011 strategic partnership agreement. And now 1,100 Afghan army officers are annually sent to India for military training. Compared with that, Pakistan, despite offering again and again through Rahil Sharif and now recently with General Bajwa, offering to train Afghan military officers, but the Ashraf Ghani government cannot decide this. a lot of opposition to this by Dr. Abdullah and many other Afghans. So that cannot happen unless there is improvement in relations. Iran is not mentioned much, but it is actively supporting Taliban to harm the US and fight ISIS. Iran has particular interest in western Afghanistan, places like Herat, Farah, Nimroz, Badghis. Drugs, water issues, Daesh, these are all issues of concern for Iran. It is backing the Afghan Taliban. We have a number of evidences regarding that. It is also interested in economic opportunities, transit trade. In fact, the transit trade is shifting from Pakistan to Iran. And when the Chabahar seaport comes online, then I think the transit trade will increase further via Iran and decrease via Pakistan. Central Asian countries, they are concerned about terrorism coming from Afghanistan, drugs, and they also would like to have trade I told you about Turkey earlier. The third person was Dostum, who got refuge in Afghanistan, in Turkey, still there. He tried to come back, but he was not allowed. What are issues of concern for Pakistan? Afghanistan-based terrorists, Indian security influence, misusing Afghan territory to destabilize Pakistan, supporting Baloch separatists, supporting TTP and Jamaatul Ahrar and others. If Pakistan can help, it would like to have a government in Kabul which is friendly and not overly pro-India. Also, Pakistan has got interest in energy trade and access to Central Asia via Afghanistan. TAPI is one big project, CASA 1000. A number of projects are coming online, and that is something, Now, India says it won't deploy troops to Afghanistan, but ready to increase development assistance. There are big projects funded by India, $2 billion until now. But by the way, Pakistan also has offered $1 billion. There is not much mention of the Pakistani development assistance. 500 million have already been almost spent. And the new announcement made for 500 million more was, as you know, President Ghani at Amritsar in the Heart of Asia conference very undiplomatically rejected that. But they haven't refused it, so I think they will take it. So we also spent money, but in the past we were wasting our money, giving it to fighters, warlords. Now we have learned our lessons. We are spending it on welfare projects, roads, schools, hospitals, scholarships. We have offered 3,000 fully funded scholarships to Afghan students to study in universities and professional colleges. And we have now offered 3,000 more, 6,000. This is beside the education being given to the Afghan refugee children, which is in lakhs. But the Indian, this is a very clever project called the Small Development Projects. It's up to $1 million for every village or town. And it is done on the community's, proposal. So they identify a water project, a road, a bridge that is executed with Indian assistance. This is the way they are winning hearts and minds. That's why we keep hearing about studies, opinion surveys saying India is one of the most popular countries in Afghanistan. Hopefully, we can do better as well. Now, there's a lot of, differences of opinion. Afghan government says India is a stabilizing factor in Afghanistan, and the US agrees. Pakistan says India is the destabilizing factor. There's no common ground. There never will be. But I think India will be incompetent and stupid not to destabilize Pakistan through Afghanistan to the Baloch separatists, to the Pakistani militants, if there's an opportunity. Because this is like tit for tat, you know, proxy wars. I think I'll finish here, but it was maybe a very depressing presentation. But you cannot be optimistic. When you look around, and if you have been following Afghanistan, if you have been going there, if you see the suffering, so you cannot be optimistic. Recent visit by the army chief, by the way, my last point, is it is something different. They say we are going to forget the past and start a new chapter in relations. Have they agreed something secretly in their one-on-one meeting? What can Pakistan do? You know, let me tell you one thing. Recently, just 3-4 days ago, there was one important Afghan special forces operation in Nangarhar province, in Lalpura district, and they have killed 7 or 8 Jamaatul Ahrar Pakistani militants. That's very significant, and I have been told by military officer, which is the second such operation in the last few months. If that is the case, if finally the Afghan government is taking action against the Pakistani militants and not harboring them, not supporting them through the NDS or through the RAW, that can change the equation. They will also expect Pakistan to do something on this side. Another thing, last point, the border management. 2,500 kilometers of border, during that. 12 billion rupees have been already approved for fencing of the border. We have only fenced 48 kilometers until now. I was told they are doing 1.25 kilometer every day. But it's such a challenging task. You have to take it on trucks up to a point. Then you have to make use of mules, khachar, to go to the heights. And there are no roads at certain places, something very big. The army is hoping that by the end of next year, they will be able to do 600 to 700 kilometers fencing. In Balochistan, they have done these trenches on the border. 500 kilometers have already been trenched in the Pakistani territory. So these are steps being taken just to seal off Pakistan, to build a wall, to build a fence. Because maybe the feeling is that there is going to be no real breakthrough in relations. The military officers nowadays talk in terms of a fata which has emerged on the Afghan side. We already had a fata on the Pakistani side. Fata means, in their view, a lawless area. But they say there's a fata now across the border. Places like Nangarhar, Kunal, Nuristan, right up to Kandahar and Helmand and Zabul. And recently you heard about two incidents. One, Lieutenant Arsalan Alam was killed by a sniper fire in Rajgal Valley, right on the border, in a very forested area. Because across the border there are no Afghan security positions. That is the Nazian area, which is occupied by Daesh and by Pakistani Taliban. Secondly, Naib Subedar Azhar Ali was martyred 2 days ago in Sandana area in Tira Valley, in Khyber again, both in Khyber. I was told the attacks were carried out by Lashkar-e-Islam, a smaller organization led by Mangal Bagh. So look at the threat level. There is sniping, attacks, and then there was retaliation by Pakistani army. Artillery was used yesterday, and the shell fell in Afghan territory in Nangarhar. So this is going to be the pattern now, I think. There will be cross-border attacks, retaliation, because Pakistan has crossed the red line. They are now retaliating with artillery fire. They are not crossing the border but they are retaliating. So that will actually become even more problematic and more challenging to improve relations. Thank you very much.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Well, I risk two things. First, after such a comprehensive presentation, I think this talk was not necessary. Secondly, is the sort of lunchtime. I'm sure everybody will be heading home or to their offices or to their eateries for lunch. And practically, I'm standing between you and your lunch. The 16 years of United States in Afghanistan have one thing in common. And that common thing is United States policy in Afghanistan was always inconsistent. It was disjointed and it was uncoordinated. The objectives were never known, and the resources put into that war were not even. The theory of managed chaos, to which a number of participants sort of alluded to during the Q&A session, actually in Afghanistan, a lot of people believe that United States want to have this managed chaos in Afghanistan, which will justify their presence there. Personally, I think this conspiracy theory would not stand a deep scrutiny. But the fact is, although United States says it, and the official orders mention it, that United States presence is temporary in Afghanistan, but in all likelihood, United States is there to stay. If you look at the US troop presence in Japan, South Korea, for example, in Germany, in all those places, the original agreements or the original orders say that the stay of US forces will be temporary. In Afghanistan, the troop presence or the US presence is temporary exactly in the same way. It will always be temporary, but that temporary period will never be defined. They have built a number of bases across Afghanistan. And interestingly, dozens of them are already bulldozed or dynamited, because they thought that if they hand them over to the Afghan troops, in a very short period of time, the Afghan Taliban will take them over. So they were bulldozed, when Obama's drawdown started. But some large bases they kept, particularly one in Farah, one in Kandahar, and one very close to Kabul. The United States will keep this option. They will have a small presence there. If needed, they can increase the presence anytime. These bases give a certain leverage to United States there, because the US forces, the contractors, even people who are engaged in economic diplomacy, they don't take visas for Afghanistan. They simply take chartered flights from places like Gulf or even from United States directly, and they land in one of these bases. They don't have an Afghan visa. And as kind of when I was at the peak of US presence in Afghanistan, I was ambassador there, one of our biggest problem is the Americans would come up with a passport and they wanted a visa for Pakistan, but they had no visa in Afghanistan. So it's not only a third country they're applying, but they're in that third country illegally. But that was sort of a pattern. So United States will keep these bases and will keep its presence in a lower presence, sometime higher presence, sometime a lot of people, sometime very few people, sometime through contractors, sometime through troops. But it will probably, in all likelihood, will remain be there. But it doesn't mean that the United States would like the chaos also there. Because US would like to stay in a peaceful Afghanistan, because that peaceful stay in a peaceful environment would bring the economic benefit, which could be the United States objective very well, which was never defined, but that could be objective. The biggest problem with the United States policy in Afghanistan in the last 16 years is that it never responded to the ground realities. When you look at the policy, every single time, and sometimes the policy changes every 6 months, every single time you look at the policy, it does not respond. It's not in response to the ground realities. It's totally devoid of ground realities. in my reckoning, the best period for the United States in Afghanistan was the early period, the first year of US presence in Afghanistan, when there were only 1,600 US troops in Afghanistan. And that was the most successful period. Taliban were defeated, there was peace in Afghanistan, a new government has returned. But you know, the problem is the follow-up. There was no follow-up at that time. At that time, almost entire Taliban leadership wanted reconciliation talks. Even Mullah Akhtar Mansoor was sitting in Tareen Court waiting after sending message for reconciliation, waiting for response from the Afghan government and the US forces. But instead of sending negotiators or calling him for negotiations, special forces were sent against him and against a number of other Taliban leaders. And then, of course, these Taliban leaders disappeared either to the mountains or to Quetta. And, you know, an insurgency started down the line. If during Bonn conference, for example, look at the scenario, if in Bonn conference, if Taliban were represented, there would have been practically no insurgency. Because this entire Taliban force could have been incorporated into the system somehow. But it was not done because the US policy was essentially guided by anger. And it was briefed by a very small Afghan elite, which were sort of against Taliban and did not want to give any share to not only to Taliban, but to anybody who did not belong to their own ethnic stock. So that was sort of, you know, the problem started there. Then, like the current US policy, if you look at it, it seems that sort of, you know, this is a statement, I would say. I won't call it a policy. It's a very initial statement. But if you look at the statement, it does not address the ground situation. You don't see an iota of the reflection of the ground situation in this. Today, United States is not in a position in which it was a few years ago. Iran supported United States in Afghanistan against Taliban. Russia supported, China supported, Pakistan supported, every single country supported United States in Afghanistan. Today the situation has changed. Today it's a totally different situation. Iran has links with Taliban. Iran has closer contacts with Taliban today than ever. And Russia has closer contacts today in Afghanistan with Taliban than Russia's contact with US on Afghanistan. China and Russia and Iran, by the way, are supporting Taliban materially also. Then look at China. China is politically supporting Taliban today. It was not the situation before. China is talking to Taliban. They have taken Taliban in the name of trade fairs and other things and talked to them, the Taliban leadership and Taliban negotiators, because new threats have emerged in Afghanistan. And all these countries think that these new threats are bigger threats than Taliban. And suddenly you see that, you know, you have a bigger evil there. And, you know, people feel sort of the need of the smaller evil called Taliban vis-a-vis United States even today. So, you know, even the current talk of policy or the policy statements from the United States does not reflect that reality. Then United States policy is away from reality in a way that Afghanistan has a very dysfunctional government. As Yusufzai Saab said, sort of in the Afghan unity government, unity is missing. It's not a united government. The Afghan foreign minister has not met his president for months. He's part of the opposition. The first vice president, who technically, constitutionally supports the security apparatus of Afghanistan, is an exile. And he is an exile because Ashraf Ghani appointed a governor to his province, and in Shibargan, you know, capital of the province, the governor was kidnapped by Dostum's people. He was sodomized and thrown out of the province. And that is the first vice president of Afghanistan doing that. And after that, you know, Dostum was in house arrest, first vice president was in house arrest. If anything happened to Ashraf Ghani, Dostum will become the president of Afghanistan. And now the first vice president is in exile. That's a government on the ground with which the United States is dealing, with which the Afghan people are dealing, and which other countries are dealing. It's a ground reality. You cannot make a policy unless you take the weakness of that government sitting in Kabul into consideration. And that, you know, most of the Afghan government today as Karzai's government, is living out of suitcases. Their families are out, their families are abroad, they are living in guest houses or in small accommodation, living practically out of suitcases. So if something happens, they can simply pick up their suitcase and take one of the flights to Dubai, and they'll be off to their destination, for which they already have their passports, their second passports. So look, these are some basic realities to which United States policy or the United States presence in Afghanistan and the increasing presence in Afghanistan does not respond to. But you know, it's not only problem on that side. The Taliban today, the new Taliban today, are much different than the original ideological Taliban. Most of the foot soldiers of Taliban movement today are essentially the Taliban of grievance, because of the bad governance, because people were treated bad, families were treated badly. There is a sort of protest against US, against the Afghan authorities, and people have joined Taliban. Today, Taliban are strong. It's not because the Taliban leadership or the Taliban movement had worked on Afghan people. No, it's not because of that. Taliban movement in Afghanistan is strong today only because the Afghan government mishandled the Afghan people in south and in the east. So essentially, they are the protest Taliban today. It's a different breed. To my mind, you know, it's much easier to talk to people who have joined insurgency as a protest. Ideological people, it's very difficult to talk to them. But people who are upset, who are angry, who are hurt, and because of that hurt or that anger, they joined Taliban movement or insurgency in protest, I think it's much easier to talk to them if you address their grievances. But you don't see anything in US policy or policy in the Afghan policy of the Afghan government of addressing those grievances. So as a result, the Afghan Taliban are getting new recruits with a very fast speed today, faster than ever before. And then, you know, we always have this debate in Washington and all other capitals of the world, and even inside Afghanistan, who will win this war? US is losing, it's not losing. Taliban winning, or in fact, if the war continues, if there is a stalemate, the militants have won it then. It's very simply their survival. I think General Durrani said that. If they simply survive, they are winning. For US to win the war, it has to win it without any doubt. But for Taliban to win it, if it continues, they are winning. And then, you know, in current policy, one thing is different than before, that, you know, like no date of withdrawal, right? With every troop increase in Afghanistan, there was a proviso about withdrawal. And that was very simple. Like, you know, Taliban would say that, okay, you have watches, we have time. You will withdraw, we are there. This is our country, we will stay there. So, you know, that is a bit of a change in United States policy. But at the same time, since the policy is not, you know, like if you look at the US administration, the entire US administration is not supporting that policy. It's only a faction in the US sort of administration, in the US establishment, which is supporting it. Even President Trump himself is not convinced with this policy. This policy goes against the grain of his presidential campaign for the election. Whatever he said in the election, he is doing exactly opposite to that, and he's saying that, well, these generals are very experienced, it's their advice, so I'm taking their advice. So actually, it's not the ownership of the US administration to this policy. And in that case, you know, it's going to be very difficult for the United States to win this war. But, you know, winning again is very interesting. In Vietnam, for example, United States won 5,000 battles, more than 5,000 battles. United States troops did not lose a single battle in Vietnam over the years. But in the end, they lost the war. And when people talk about the winning of United States or losing of United States, tell me, since Second World War, where did United States win? It lost everywhere. Because it does not have the, I mean, it's an empire. Right? It's the Roman Empire of, you know, is the Rome of 21st century. But they do not have that finesse which empires used to have. That finesse which will give them victory. So United States goes into these countries, several wars, 14 wars, maybe 30 wars, $14 trillion spent, but they lose every single war. So, you know, the outcome in Afghanistan will not be different. But it's not because Taliban are very strong, or Taliban are very brave, or they have a better strategy. No, it's because the United States strategy is very faulty, and it's very bad, and they are making too many enemies, not only inside Afghanistan, but also in the region. And then, you know, the other thing is, if United States withdraw, the Afghan National Army is not ready actually to fight this battle. Some of their units, a couple of brigades, are very good, there's no doubt in that, and they did prove their mettle in the battle. But most of the Afghan National Army is not ready for a battlefield. But at the same time, you know, Taliban also cannot overrun Afghanistan entirely. They cannot cross the ethnic fault line. They have people now, they have a lot of Uzbek fighters now, they have Turkmen fighters and a lot of Tajik fighters actually. But the fact is, they cannot cross the ethnic fault line. They can sort of take over a city here and there in the north briefly, they can take over a village, they can attack a provincial headquarter or something, but they cannot hold it. Beyond the ethnic fault line, they cannot be successful. Because, you know, one thing is very clear. What happened since the American arrival in Afghanistan? Parts of Afghanistan has seen unprecedented growth and development. There are more universities in Afghanistan today than ever. There are more roads, there are more schools, there are more dispensaries. You know, so, you know, it's a different Afghanistan in which Taliban will be operating. In South and East, you don't see that development. But in West and North, you see that development very clearly. And that's a big gap beyond ethnic fault line. So Taliban are actually representing the unprivileged, depressed, underdeveloped areas of Afghanistan. And then, you know, there's another argument that 60 or 70% of Afghanistan is under Taliban control. But if you look at the population-wise, it's a very small fraction. Because Afghanistan has now very big cities. The cities have grown. Kabul, which was a city of 700,000 people before the Soviet sort of came to Kabul, is today a city of 4.5 million people. Similarly, every single country, every single city, you know, is, for example, you know, Mazar Sharif, for example, Harar, for example, Jalalabad, all these cities are very big cities and with huge populations. So Taliban might control or have influence in a big chunk of Afghan territory. But if you look at the population, it is a very small population. And then Taliban have now also challenges like ISIS. Inside the Taliban fighters, now you see very clear groups. There are people who are actually have nothing ideological with Afghan. They don't share any ideology with the Afghan Taliban, but they're fighting side by side. Some of them are even outright criminals. So, you know, like, the situation is quite murky. It's not very, very clear. And one sort of other important factor is, when you go to Afghanistan, when you meet Afghan people, I think it's the only country in the world where even the civil society supports foreign occupation. Civil societies by definition are supposed to be against foreign occupation, right, or foreign influences. In Afghanistan, the entire civil society, I don't know a single civil society organization in Afghanistan, not a single civil society organization in Afghanistan which oppose American presence or American occupation or US occupation or foreign presence in Afghanistan. Similarly, Afghan media, almost entire Afghan media supports foreign presence, and almost entire Afghan media is supported by the foreign forces or by the foreign country. Every newspaper, every TV channel, every radio channel, you know immediately who is supporting it, who is funding it. So also this is a very sort of very interesting aspect of Afghan society today, which is very un-Afghan. I don't call it Afghan, because Afghans historically were always against foreign occupation or against foreign forces. But here you see a totally different paradigm. And this paradigm shift happened in the last 16 years. And last but not the least, you know, you do not see peace coming to Afghanistan, not very soon, because the bounties of war are much bigger. Now, bounties of war are much bigger than the dividend of peace. Today, almost all the rich people in Afghanistan are rich because of this war. Even Taliban, when they were in the government, they were very poor. Today, they are very rich. They have businesses, not only in Pakistan and in UAE, but in several other countries. So people are getting rich. People who can do something about this war, either on the government side or in the insurgency side, are getting rich because of this war. And if people are getting rich, personal interest always overtakes the national interest or the ideological interest. People are getting rich, so why the war won't stop? You know, Afghanistan, because of this war, is almost becoming a narco state. In last cabinet, at least one third of the ministers were involved. Karzai's own family were openly involved in drug trade. You know, so the problem is when a war brings so much money, how would you stop people from fighting? Because the moment the fighting stops, you have to address the narco problem. The moment the fighting stops, you cannot have you cannot have these kidnappings for money, ransom for money, and you cannot have foreign supporting giving you money. The flow of foreign funds would stop. So you know, all these things actually have created a culture of war in Afghanistan today. So this is actually the aspect, some positive, mostly negative, which does not give us a lot of hope in Afghanistan. But the fact is, historically, you know, Afghan society believes in negotiations. You know, the jarga system. You know, they have the they consult with each other and they finally find a solution to their problems. But as long as foreigners are there, as long as people are interfering, and when I say that people are interfering, I mean us also. As long as we are there and others are there, there will be no peace in Afghanistan. If you leave Afghans to their own machinations, they have the capacity, they have the capability to reach the peace, to talk to each other, to find a solution. But if the foreigners are there, including Pakistanis, if the foreigners are there, everybody in Afghanistan will push the envelope. And this envelope is going to fall.